Good evening. We're going to be in Genesis, of course, and this one is called In His Likeness. In His Likeness. And you'll find out why when we get there, but let's read Genesis 1, 9 through 13 with me. And God said, "Let the water under the heaven be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. And the earth brought forth grass and herb yielding seed after its kind, his kind, and the tree yielding fruit whose seed was in itself after his kind. And God saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the third day." Lord, we thank you for everything as we continue to look at your creation and how perfect and how important and how it was a shadow of things to come. And we just thank you that you are so perfect in all your ways, that you have done all this to prepare us, to give us a pattern of what we can expect. And Lord, we thank and praise you for that. And we say this in your name, amen. Now, we've been really following the work of recreation done by the Holy Spirit. The first thing I want you to notice, though, is first of all, the Spirit had to move. It had to move up on what was there, which was basically the waters, to recreate everything. And this is a problem today because the Holy Spirit's not moving. And he's not moving because the ground is not being prepared. He will not land on the unholy. He will not contend with rebellious, stiff-necked people. He will not reprove. He will not convict. He will not move. And because he's not moving today, people, his presence is not being established in the church today. His work is not being done in the church today. And this is a big vexation in my spirit, because the whole purpose of why the church is here to see salvation. And salvation cannot be accomplished unless the presence of the Holy Spirit is there to bring forth that conviction and that work. But he can't entrust his church with that work, because his church is not ready to raise up to the occasion and bring that new soul forth in discipleship. And so what we see today is that he wants to move on the barren terrain of man's stagnant souls. And he wants to bring form, purpose. He wants to fill the void. He wants to consume the darkness. But man's not ready and prepared for his work. And that's the tragedy today. God is so willing, but man is not. God is so ready, and man's not. God is prepared to do the impossible, and man doesn't believe it. And so we are in this sort of limbo situation. Now, he must move upon in order to establish his presence and work. But the problem today with many in the so-called church is that they're content to play at church instead of being the church. And the difference is you have to be the church, because the Holy Spirit is preparing the church to come forth without what? Without spot, wrinkle, and blemish. He's got to send forth that fire. He's got to send forth the water to purify. And man's not prepared for that. But the true church is being prepared. And that's what we need to understand. The true church, which is universal, is being prepared for the coming of Christ. And I fear for many people in America, because they're not being prepared. Now, as we talked about, the Holy Spirit must divide And that starts with darkness and light. And the Lord God spoke that light into being so the Holy Spirit could begin to separate and divide, begin to show us and bring contrast between the darkness and the light. The light has to penetrate the darkness before God can begin to bring forth that order through His Holy Spirit, who brings contrast. Now, we talked about the darkness must be identified by the light. You don't know what darkness is until the light's there. The light of truth. The light of His Spirit. And of course, the light is limited by the lesser light, which we talked about as the promises. So many times, how many of you realize that the promise is just one of the lesser lights? But when you're going through dark times, you grab a hold of those promises, that lesser light, until the real light and revelation of Jesus Christ can finally shine through the situation. You hold on to those things before you see the great light. And that's what we're seeing here, that we're seeing the pattern of the lesser light always pointing to the greater light. The reason that darkness has to be identified is because man declares that darkness is light, if there's no contrast. And I want you to know today, this is another vexation of my spirit. The church is not bringing that contrast. The church is not the light. They are hiding their light under a bunch of compromise and sin. Now the waters must be separated for the heavens to be distinguished, which happened on the second day. Now we talked about the fact that without the light, the heavens can't be distinguished. There are three heavens, of course. Now this prepares the way for the third day, because the heavens were revealed on the second day, and land is separated on the third day from the waters of the earth. Now the light comes to reveal the heaven while earth serves as the platform. It serves as a platform. Man looks at the heavens, but it's from the platform of earth. Man can observe the heavens. As I told you, earth is located so man can look at space. Man can see the unfolding of heaven, of the second heaven. But guess what? Even all the heavens can't contain the glory, the power of God. That's how big our God is. And yet we try to limit Him in so many ways. Now there must be land so that the seeds of life can be planted in the ground. And we see this in verse 11. And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, the seed and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth, and it was so. Now we have seed. You know, people always ask the question, what came first, the egg or the chicken? The chicken did. Why? Because within that chicken is the seed of life. God created everything in maturity so it could reproduce. Adam wasn't a baby, he was a man. And so what comes first? The grass or the seed? The herb or the seed? The tree or the fruit? What comes first? It's the mature plant. God created that. God called it in the being, and the Holy Spirit situated it. And what you have to understand, people, and this is so important, is that life is what brings form. Life is what fills the void. And there is light in life that penetrates the darkness. Now, we don't even think about what life does. But without life, there would be no form. Everything would be void. What's the purpose of anything if it doesn't possess and contain life? We don't think about those things. Now, God commands us to be so. And only the Holy Spirit can impart such life in order to recreate the barren, lifeless landscape. And that's true for you. The only way the Holy Spirit can bring any form to you is by bringing forth the life of Christ. The only way the Holy Spirit can fill that void in your life is with the reality of Christ. The only way the darkness is going to be penetrated is because of what Jesus Christ did and who he is. It comes through life. And the main purpose of the Holy Spirit is to recreate for the purpose of bringing forth life. This is why man in his lifeless, unregenerate state must be born again, born from above, born of the breath of God, the breath of God, the breath of the Spirit. Because you have to realize that the breath of God departed from Adam when he went into rebellion against God. When he became an enemy of God, the breath of God lifted from him because there was no point of agreement. Born again means you again receive the breath of God. The present, the beauty of the Holy Spirit. And he represents the presence of God in your midst. Man became an enemy in his rebellion. And the tragedy is he continues to be an enemy. Now notice the term after his kind, which means to portion out species to come out of. I want you to know something. According to God's creation, nothing can produce anything outside of what has been created to be. Does that make sense? The apple tree cannot produce an orange tree. It can only reproduce itself. Now, why is this important? Because God, when he created everything, it was his way of bringing forth order in creation. Now, I don't know about you, but I think today men are playing God with genetics. I want you to think about what I just said. And I want you to think of it in line of what was just said here in Scripture. That God designed everything that he created. He designed it so it can reproduce itself. And that it cannot step outside of that. Now, he did that to maintain order. But man is getting in, and what is he doing now? Well, what man always does, he perverts. He perverts everything. The problem is when you get away from God's design, and that's in genetics, what you're going to end up with is chaos. That's what you're going to end up with. And what we are seeing right now, all this genetics, all this intertwining of species, it cannot be anything but destructive to God's perfect order. Anytime man steps outside of that order of God, when they say, I don't have to live within the design of God, you know then, man is not only becoming lawless, he's becoming destructive. He is going against what God has ordained. Do we see this in everything? Yes. We see it in marriage. Man is going out and say, well, God's definition of marriage is not fair. So we're just going to redefine it. And guess what we have? We have a sick, perverted society. And we have children that don't have any understanding of what true family is, what a mom and a dad is. We call it tolerant. No, it is total fornication. It's an abomination to God. To mess with anything of God is an abomination of God because it was created perfect. It was created according to his design. No man has any right to try to pervert it because in doing so, he will destroy the soul of man. He will destroy what God has ordained. And he will go to hell for it. There are people on their way to hell. They can walk around with their New Age concepts. They can go to Christian churches and say, oh, God loves me in my perversion and my abomination, and he's going to understand it because he made me that way. No, he did not. You have bought the lie of the world. You have bought Satan, and you're going to spend eternity in hell with him because you bought the lie instead of God's design and order. Satan would let go of you if you said, I believe God, and you're a liar, Satan. But man won't. Because man prefers darkness because his deeds are evil. That's what he prefers. And he becomes lawless. He becomes lawless towards God. And he dictates his own laws. Man will never approve on God's design because God said it's good. It's pleasurable, it's acceptable to me. And any attempt of man to do so is arrogant, rebellious, and destructive. Let's look at this in light of what happened, because when man fell, this is what happened. Romans chapter 8. This really lays it out. Romans chapter 8. We're going to be looking at verses 22 and 23. Now look at what man has done. This is man's doing. Not God's doing, man's doing, because he refuses to humble himself before a holy God and accept God's design and plan. 22, it says, for we know that the whole creation groans and travails in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. Even we are ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. All man can do is cause sorrow and make creation groan when they step outside what God's plan is today. This concept, save the well and sacrifice every child that gets in the way, that is from the pit of hell. And we are a nation who has created one of the greatest crimes of Holocaust against the unborn that I can imagine. Now, I know we don't stand alone. Europe is out there. But we stand judged because we know better. Because we were founded on something that called us to something more excellent. And then to give in to base selfishness and sacrifice our children on the altars of selfishness. Unborn babies. People, it's time we call sin what it is. God can forgive the woman who has an abortion. But it's time that we quit lying and quit deceiving ourselves and call it what it is. God can forget those who live perverted and abominable lifestyles. But they have to call it what it is. And cry out for God's mercy because they know they're under his judgment. Because that's what the Bible says. Now remember, the land was shaped by the water, but defined the water. And all this happened on the third day. It was on the land that Jesus Christ was lifted up, where he paid for our sins. John 8. 32 and 33 talks about, actually it's John 12, excuse me, John 12, 32. It says, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. This, he says, signifying what death he should die on the cross. Jesus was lifted above the darkness of man on the cross to pay the price for us. He was put in the bowels of the earth for 3 days and 3 nights. And on the third day, he rose again. But what does his resurrection point to? This is very important. I want you to turn with me to 1 Corinthians 15. This is very important. Remember, there's a pattern here. We're going to look at that pattern. 1 Corinthians 15, beginning in verse 20, and it says, "But now is Christ risen from the dead and become what? The first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all died, even so in Christ shall all be made alive." Now what came forth on the third day that could reproduce itself? Well, the seed came forth. What came forth on the resurrection of Christ? The seed, the first fruits of a new creation. Isn't that what's happening here? All this is coming forth in a new creation. And that's what happened for you and I. Because Jesus' resurrection is that seed that's been planted in our heart through the believing of the gospel in order to bring forth what? That fruit of everlasting life. On the third day, Jesus was the first fruits that was produced to bring forth this new creation. And where do we fit in this scheme? Romans 8:29. For whom, listen, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate us to what? To be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. What does that tell you? The life that he gives us is capable of reproducing itself. And because of what he did, we are to what? Be conformed to his likeness. Image means likeness. A whole new creation. How important is that new creation? Well, that one that we're leaving behind is dead, is doomed, is going to be completely judged. The only way we can escape it is become part of this new creation. But that means that that seed of his life has to be planted in our hearts through faith in what he did on the cross. We are to be part of a new creation that was established by Jesus Christ. His death planted that seed into the ground of new life, so it could reproduce itself in you and I. Look at what John 12:23 and 24 says. This is very important. How many times have we read this? And Jesus answered them, saying, "The hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified." Now he says, this is how I'm going to be glorified. And what is that going to require? "Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it breatheth forth much fruit." I was reading in a book called Beyond Humiliation, and he said this, and I didn't know this, so that's why I'm reading it. "It is only as the seed dies that it attracts to itself the carbon, the nitrogen, and the various salts that contribute to the nurture of the grain, and that lie in the earth unused and unproductive until a power comes into contact with them that brings them forth from their lurking places." All the right ingredients were there when Jesus died. But guess what happened? There was a power that came. And it brought all that together so that life could come out of it. And that power is the Holy Spirit. So when Jesus raised up, it was with new life. It was in a glorified body. And he says, guess what? Everybody born of my seed is going to be raised up in a new body, a glorified body. But they have to go through the process of death. That's why Jesus said, what? Deny yourself and pick up your cross and follow me. Because there has to be a death before that new creation can come forth. Regenerated, revived. Now you notice that this life is planted in open hearts in order to bring forth the life of Jesus. And we are born again to become part of a new creation. We already know. What does 2 Corinthians 5:17 say about new creation? Well, let's look at that. I could quote it, but right now I'm afraid I'm going to get it wrong, so I'm just going to read it to you. Make sure I get it right, not my paraphrase. Okay, 2 Corinthians 5:17. We hear it all the time, but how many of us really think about what had to take place for this to happen and what it means for us? Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are to become new. Because we're part of a new creation. Now it's important to point out that this seed that's in us of life, eternal life, it's important to point out it's meant to be reproduced in others. That's what it's meant to be. It's not meant to just be for us. It's capable of being reproduced. In other words, it's capable of being passed on to others. But are we doing that? That's why we've been given a commission. It says, preach the gospel, because within the gospel is that seed of life. It says, go out and make disciples. In that process, you nurtured that life. We are here for one reason, to reproduce the life of Christ in others. That's why we're here. And how many of us are fulfilling that commission today? How many of us even care people are lost? How many of us are willing to sit in our pews while people go to hell? How many of us are like Jonah, hiding in the bottom of the ship and sleeping? Why people are perishing. So much of what I see in the church in America is they have no vision. And you know why? Because they're so 100% selfish. And they don't care. They're on their way to heaven. Why do they care if anyone else gets to heaven? Oh, well, that's nice if someone bops in there and happens to get saved accidentally. Because they don't expect anything else. Why would they expect it? The Spirit's not there. Why would the Spirit be there? To revive them. And do they want to be revived? Or are they just comfortable in their church pews? Doing it as they always have done. The Spirit will conform believers to the image or likeness of Christ. And they will become like-minded as they take on His attitude. That attitude will lead you to service, sacrifice. Let's look at that in Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. Remember what I said, like-minded. Like-minded means you are totally in line, agreement, attitude with something. So let's begin in 2. Fulfill you my joy that you be what? Like-minded. Having the same, look at that, love. Being of one accord, agreement, of one mind, one purpose. Let nothing be done through strife. This is a reason that there's no agreement today, because there's so much pride, strife, or vainglory. But in lowliness, there is no meekness today. Lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. Look not every man on his own thing, but every man also on the things of others. In other words, quit being selfish and look around you. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. If God did not look around and care, Jesus would have not died on the cross. Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection produced the seed that would bring every believer forth in the likeness of the Son of God in his humanity. It is important that this life were brought forth when? When was it brought forth? Well, look at that. It's very interesting. And the evening and the morning, it was brought forth in the morning. When was Jesus raised? In the morning. In the morning. He rose from the dead in the morning. He came forth in a new glorified body. Because everything was now being brought in the right order. Clearly, the reality of the gospel is being represented in the initial introduction of the Spirit moving upon the waters. That initial condition of where how the world was at the time points to man's plight due to sin. Remember, the gospel is that Christ died for sinners. And we get that plight up front in Genesis about man's unregenerate soul. Then the light shines in the great darkness, revealing the plan of heaven, the plan of heaven's salvation. On the third day, it points to the place that Christ would be lifted up from and buried, the land. But on the third day, also points to the firstborn of every plant, of every tree that came forth to serve as the first fruits of creation. What a glorious picture, because resurrection points to what? The first fruits coming forth in glory. It's all there. The gospel's right there. It's right there for us to see. God's heart is right there. Is it no wonder God's order in creation verifies and declares the reality of his Son's redemption? So the question is, and I know all your hearts, but I still have to ask this in case anybody else listens. What about you? If you are born again, you need to know you're part of the first fruits of a new creation. And you should be reflecting the very image of Jesus, his life and his attitude. And if you're not, then you need to go back to the drawing board and find out where you missed him and where you closed down the move and the work of the Spirit in your life. So as we come to this point, before we go into worship, I want you to ask God to show you what it means to be part of this new creation. What it really means. And what God wants to do in and through you because of it.